Hello, hello, everyone. Good evening. It is so good to be here with you all for our webinar this evening, Arthritis Solutions, Simple Changes, Big Results. I will be your moderator for this evening's webinar. My name is Sherelle Moore Tucker, and I am so excited to get started with today's webinar. So a little bit about me as I serve as your moderator for today. I have been living with arthritis for well over 10 years. I actually received my own personal diagnosis while serving in the U.S. Army. So I am an Army veteran. So I definitely am going to also benefit from this webinar myself. And I'm sure that you have your own stories of living with arthritis as well. And so one of the things that I just wanted to share about me, along with my, you know, being a military veteran, is one of the solutions that was helpful for me when I initially received my diagnosis of osteoarthritis in my lower back was mindfulness practices such as meditation and yoga. And I've been practicing now since, oh gosh, maybe 2008. And it has been so beneficial and helpful for me as I deal with flare-ups. I'm sure you have your own experiences with different flare-ups and whatnot. And so with that, with today's webinar, we're going to talk about solutions. And we understand that medications are an important part of managing arthritis, especially those living with inflammatory types of arthritis like rheumatoid arthritis and psoriatic arthritis. However, there are certain lifestyle changes and healthy habits that I believe can help you control symptoms and live life more fully. And tonight we're going to focus on some lifestyle changes, which I'm really excited about. Lifestyle changes for arthritis and how to make those healthy habits stick. That's the thing. We want to make these healthy habits stick, not just for January, but throughout the entire year. And so today's guest and expert will guide us through how to create a simple plan for arthritis that can add up to big improvements over time. So I hope that you're ready for tonight's webinar. Maybe you want to take notes or grab your action plan. So with that, we're going to go to the next slide, and I want to go over a few housekeeping rules. First and foremost, you probably already noticed that all attendees have been muted. And if you have any questions now or throughout tonight's webinar, you can use the Q&A function, which you'll find at the bottom of your device or your laptop. And you can type your questions in there whenever they come up for you. We will also have a Q&A towards the end of the presentation. And with that Q&A, it'll give you an opportunity to ask more specific questions related to tonight's webinar. And we also have our helpline. If you are not able to get your questions answered tonight, you can always go to arthritis.org/ our helpline, and you can also go to our insights. At the end of our presentation, we'll also have a post-event survey that we really hope that you will complete. It doesn't take too much of your time, so hopefully you will have an opportunity to do that as well. So I think that's it for our housekeeping, and we're going to go to the next slide, and it is my pleasure to introduce you to Dr. Liz Rook, who is tonight's expert. And so let me tell you a little bit about Dr. Rook. She is a life coach and a rheumatologist, and she has spent the last 12 years helping thousands of patients and clients make impactful lifestyle changes while unlocking the power of their own minds. I love that. And her passion was born from over 30 years of overeating to cope with problems and avoid conflict. And she uses a unique 3-method system to develop self-awareness, allowance, and acceptance to solve the root cause of disease. This innovative approach creates new neural pathways in the brain and simplifies both mindset shifts and habit change. She has a free stress reduction guide on her website, which you can see right here on the slide, thrivearena.com, and she shares life-changing content on her podcast entitled Reclaim Your Brain. Everyone, give a warm welcome in your own way to Dr. Rook. Welcome, Dr. Rook. We're so glad that you're joining us tonight.
Thank you, Sherelle. I am so excited and honored to be here and to have been asked to speak for the Arthritis Foundation. I have been part of the Arthritis Foundation since I was in training. I love what they do. I love how they empower patients to take control of their lives and heal and thrive, no matter what your diagnosis is, no matter what's going on. And my passion is helping especially women in power, but everyone, because as humans, we start off real good and then life happens and stuff gets in the way and you can get stuck and it's really hard to move forward. So we're going to talk first about the goals for tonight. We're going to get started on creating a plan for success with habit change. So y'all got to use your brains just a little bit tonight, just a little bit. Okay. And then we're going to create a plan together and then we're going to get going, and I'm getting ahead of myself. So tonight we're talking about how resolutions, we all make them at the beginning of the year, and usually by the end of February, they're gone, right? I've done it before. If you have, maybe just raise your virtual hand, right? So resolutions rarely stick. The statistics say that over 80% of people abandon their resolutions by February. We are almost there. February starts next week. Only 8% of people follow through and actually get the changes that they set out to make. Y'all, we're turning those numbers on their heads tonight. You all, you're here, or even if you're watching the replay, you can create simple changes to feel better and thrive with arthritis. And I'm so excited to show you how. We're going to blend neuroscience, psychology, mindset, and strategy all into one to get you results tonight. Whatever you're doing right now, how you're sitting, how you're listening, how you're watching, if you're multitasking, what you ate today, what time you got up, what time you go to bed, what you're thinking on repeat, how you talk to yourself, how you talk to other people, all of it is a habit. Okay. We don't usually think about it like that, but I'm going to challenge you to think and see things a little bit differently tonight. And that is going to make all the difference. What we do when we're tired, when we're hungry, when we're hurting, all habits. Okay. The goal of any habit is to return us to safety and comfort and normalcy. And knowing that, it makes it easier to shift and be able to hold and allow space for discomfort. Okay. And also, I want to mention before we dive in, what we focus on expands. And I know firsthand, when you're in pain, it's hard to focus on anything else. The pain is just right in front of your face, or, you know, in front of your hand, and it can be overwhelming and it can shut you down. So it's hard to function. And I think we've all experienced that at one time or another. But that's our default setting. We're going to come back to this theme over and over because repetition helps get it inside and incorporate it into your life. So by default, our brain is set up to protect us. It's set up to keep us safe and to always scan for danger. And pain is a danger signal that something's not right. So when we're focused on our pain, we're focused also on our problem. And just know that there's nothing wrong with that. Normal human brain, your brain's working well if it's focused on your pain. But when we're focused on pain, we're not focused on solutions and moving forward and creating change, because change feels scary. But I'm also going to help you bust through that tonight. So even if it's a little scary, even if it's uncomfortable, even if you started and stopped a diet plan or an exercise plan or a change in habit, going to bed earlier, getting up later, getting support of your family, drinking more water, trying to meditate, don't beat yourself up for it. We're going to talk more about that. Just know that wherever you're starting, you already have an advantage because you've already done it before and you get to build on those skills. Okay. Next slide, please. We kind of all know, and we dove in a little bit already, why doing this mindset and habit work is so important. And I'm going to talk with my hands. So if it's distracting you, just focus on the slides. I'm half Italian. So that's kind of how we roll. Arthritis affects us all, not only physically, but mentally and emotionally as well. Forming healthy habits, how we think, how we act, how we feel, how we process through feelings, right? How we respond to anything is critical for functioning well, for relieving our pain, and for thriving in our life and our health. By incorporating small, simple changes, they add up over time, and that helps us improve our energy, our functionality, and our optimism despite our discomfort. Okay, knowledge is power. I truly believe this. The more we know and the more we can practice awareness and catch ourselves in our current habits without judging and criticizing ourselves, the easier it becomes to shift out of that habit. Once you're aware of it, once you understand why you're doing it, it makes it easier to shift, especially when we remove that extra weight of criticism or that negative self-talk around it. Our secret weapon is our ability to change our thoughts and our feelings around anything, but especially around our habits. And our habits and mindset, like we've already touched on, profoundly affect our health. You're going to leave this webinar a different person than how you started it. And I'm excited for that. You are going to be experiencing a shift tonight, and I'm so excited to be your guide. Next slide, please. So what we're going to talk about is a multifaceted approach to thriving with arthritis. We're going to give you some ideas for goals you can set if you didn't come with one already. We did create a worksheet for this workshop, that you can use as a guide. And if you didn't get it ahead of time, it's totally okay. You can just sit and listen and then always watch the recording later and go back and take notes, or just grab a pen and a paper just to jot down ideas or to answer the questions as we go through, so that by the time you're done, you have a written plan that you can start taking action on immediately. Okay. We're going to talk tonight about three common mistakes that we all make when we're trying to change our habits, especially our health habits, and then three simple shifts you can instead make to create the habits and make them shift. Okay. And you can start this work tonight. The worksheet is also in your reminder email that you got for this event, and it will be available in the post-survey email as well. So if you didn't get it, just keep an eye out for that. And like I said, don't worry about it. Either just listen, take it all in, or just grab a post-it note and a crayon and just go for it. All right, next slide. So I always approach arthritis treatment and health and healing with my patients from a holistic perspective. And a lot of times we get focused on the physical symptoms because that's what we're feeling, the pain, the stiffness, the immobility, but there's also emotional symptoms attached to that. And that includes the self-criticism of why can't I just feel better? I should be able to do this. We get frustrated, we get angry, and especially if it's a chronic disease diagnosis, you can feel sad, you can feel anxious. And a lot of times we need that time and space to grieve the life we used to have versus the life we're going to create. And I always tell my patients, we create new normal. And sometimes, and a lot of the time, it's better than old normal. And then they get excited because they can't wait to get there. So it's a lot of it is how we talk to ourselves and how we think about it. But if we're not aware that there are different ways to approach our treatment and our plan and our pain, even in the moment and long-term, then we don't know and we can't take action. And that's why awareness is so important. I also like to talk to them about their self-concept. We're going to talk a little bit about spirit and nature, but that has a lot to do with our self-talk. And then we focus on nutrition, sleep, movement, and creating calm and coming back to a center, grounded, safe feeling place where you know that you can always take action from versus feeling frantic and urgent. And that intensifies the pain a lot of times, because think about it, like a cornered animal. If we're backed into a corner and we can't see any solutions because all we see is our problem, it's not actually a problem. It's our normal human brain just trying to protect us. And a lot of times it just kind of shuts down. And it's totally normal, and you totally can move forward from it, usually with help, but sometimes on your own. And we're going to talk through all that tonight. And then if you have questions at the end, just put them in the Q&A and we'll talk through it. Okay, let's see. I think I'm done with this slide, but give me 1 second. Just want to check my notes. Okay, I do want to touch on stress, because both Sherelle and I are just passionate about mindfulness as a stress reduction tool. And I say awareness versus mindfulness, and it's just kind of my spin on it because that worked better for me when I was learning this work. And I want you to acknowledge that when you're feeling physically unwell or emotionally unwell, you're tired, you're stressed, you're feeling uncomfortable, or you're just feeling overwhelmed or like your head's gonna pop off. I know we've all felt like that. If we're pushing it away or trying to ignore it, it's like trying to push a beach ball down under the water, right? You have the beach ball, you're pushing it down. You can hold it there for a certain amount of time, then it's gonna pop back up again. And I like to think of stress as we're boiling water and we have the pressure cooker on. And if we don't let the steam vent every so often, it builds up and then the top can blow off. And that's true with us as humans as well. And any stress we're pushing away tends to create a cycle that creates more stress. Stress is a resistance or a pressure. And awareness is a tool to kind of release that pressure valve or let the ball pop up out of the water so that the pressure's not building up. And there are many techniques for this. Sherelle focuses a lot on mindfulness and yoga. I talk about mindfulness and meditation as tools, visualization, but also just pausing and acknowledging, hey, I don't feel great today, or I'm having pain, or I'm kind of beating myself up because I told myself I wasn't going to eat that big old bowl of ice cream last night, but it was so good. Okay. So just that first step is just awareness. And when we can pause and slow down, we're able to get out of that pain, stress kind of feedback loop that feels like a merry-go-round that you just can't get off of because it's spinning too fast, or like a washing machine where you're just getting thrown around and you can't open the door, right? We want you to be able to connect your mind and your body back together so that you can create your best physical, emotional, and mental health, because they all play on each other. So that's what a holistic approach really is noticing how your mind and spirit are affecting your body, how it physically feels. And then from there, we can come from a knowledgeable, aware, empowered place to create changes in our nutrition, in our exercise, in our sleep, in our mindset, in our hydration, or any habit that you're looking to change. And I also want to offer that your mindset is not fixed. A lot of people are like, well, I'm just a pessimist, or this is how I've just always been. Right, because that neural pathway is deep in your brain. It's like a well-worn path in the snow. It's worn in, it's not as cold, you know where you're going, it's easy, right? New neural pathways, which are how your neurons fire and connect and create new habits, right? You can teach an old dog new tricks. You just got to give them enough treats. And that's what we're going to do tonight. You want to create the new neural pathway, but your brain is telling you no, because the snow is deep, it's cold, it's wet, and you don't want to go that way because the other pathway is easier, but it's also not taking you in the direction you want to go anymore. It was serving its purpose for a while, and now it's not. So when you know that it's going to be a little bit uncomfortable, the snow is going to be a little deep, your shoes might get wet, you can prepare for that ahead of time and then walk in that path. Optimism is a habit that you can learn, and you don't have to be positive all the time. You don't have to ignore anything negative, but you don't want to ignore it either, because that also creates stress. All right, next slide, please. So we're going to talk about different habits that you can partake in. And this is something you can put either on your worksheet or a piece of paper. I'd like you to think of one habit that you want to change, whether that has to do with nutrition or energy, so like sleep or exercise, or stress reduction, or maybe you want to drink more water. Just think of one thing and just jot it down, okay? Either on your piece of paper or on the worksheet, because your goals are going to be unique for you, for the type of arthritis you have, and what you want both short-term and long-term in your life. I talk to my patients a lot about an N of one. You want to take ideas and input from other sources, from other experts, from something you saw on the internet, from your friends and family who always have such helpful recommendations for arthritis, right? And then decide what works for you and just let go of the rest. Because you get to decide what works best for you based on trial and error, and also just applying it and deciding like, no, that's not for me. I'm not going to eat rice cakes every day of the week. Trust me, I'm with you on that one. So one small step at a time is the other thing that I just want to drive home tonight. And we're going to break it down, but you're going to also want to start smaller than you think you need to. We're going to talk about why that is. So some examples of healthy habits, if you came just kind of open and you hadn't really thought through what you wanted to maybe focus on and change as a result of this webinar, is that you can think about eating healthier, because eating different types of food can help reduce inflammation for various types of both inflammatory and degenerative arthritis, like osteoarthritis, and maybe incorporating more of certain foods and maybe eating less of others. And so for my patients, most of the time we start with the basics. Are you eating regularly? And then creating awareness around what you're eating currently. Because a lot of us think we're eating a certain way, but then we forget about all the little snacking we do, or that bite of food, or grab food off our kid's plate, or we had a treat, someone offered it at work. Our brain conveniently forgets all that food as a protective mechanism so we don't beat ourselves up later, right? So what I tell my patients is we start with the basics. Processed food, so boxed, packaged food, stuff with a lot of sodium in it, those can flare arthritis, and then sugar. Those are the two big things. And I love sugar myself, so I always commiserate with my patients when they're sugar people too, because I get it. I totally get it. It's delicious, and it's not the best for your arthritis. And then things like exercise, working out, increasing mobility, keeping cartilage healthy, that whole if you don't move it, you lose it adage, right? And then managing stress. Because stress increases cortisol levels, which can flare arthritis and other connective tissue diseases. And that will help us as we reduce stress overall. It helps you cope better and create healthier coping mechanisms for when you are flaring or when you are feeling stress from your physical health or for emotional reasons. And it can also reduce disease flares and control skin symptoms and things like psoriatic arthritis. Okay, so next slide. So I'm hoping right now that you're picking a habit that you want to change, just go ahead and write it down either in the space on the worksheet or just on a sheet of paper, or just hold it in your head, okay? And then I want you to kind of think for a second, like, how confident am I that I can create that change? With zero being, heck no, there's no way I'm going to do that. Or 10 being like, that's done. It's already in the bag, even though I haven't done it yet. I know I can do that every single day for the rest of my life, okay? So just take a second. 0 to 10, how confident are you that you can change and create this habit? And then once you just have a good idea, and listen, if your brain's overthinking, totally normal too. This is not a test. We're not going to collect papers at the end of the class. Okay, just best guess, whatever comes to your mind. If you say 7 or 8 or 2 or 5, that's fine. Just write it down. This is just for you. You want to think about what obstacles are in the way of you having already created that habit. Is it because it's hard to get to the store, you're not the one who cooks, you don't have access to a gym or a pool, because a lot of times we talk about pool therapy for arthritis patients because it takes the weight off the joints. You don't have time, you don't feel like you have enough energy to get up and get moving and do the program that you wanna do. Just jot down a couple of ideas of maybe 3 different things, obstacles that are standing in your way right now. So now we're gonna dive in, and this is a lot of information and we're diving kind of deep, but I know you can hang with me. So just grab on. We're going to dive under the surface and then we're going to come back up for air. But you may want to listen to this more than once if this is all new information for you, because repetition helps our brains, right, rewire those neural pathways and then implement. Because the goal of creating a new habit is to do it enough times that it becomes your natural default. And our brain loves to be efficient. It loves to save energy and just go on default. Think about it like driving a car. When you first learned how to drive, you had to concentrate a lot of energy and skill on even just turning the car on, making sure your seatbelt's on, putting it in drive or reverse, and then you're looking around at all your mirrors, and maybe you're going 10 miles an hour and you're freaking out because it's too much and there's too much going on. You slam on the brakes. Just me, not anyone else? Okay, fine. It's fine. But just think about it like that. When you first learned how to drive, it took a lot of concentration because you were learning a new skill and creating new neural pathways. And so for anyone who thinks, well, I've never been able to be successful at anything before, I'm going to tell you right now, you're wrong, because there's a lot of stuff you've learned to do, including learning how to walk, learning how to read, learning how to count, learning how to do virtually anything you've done has required this same work. And now you can probably drive multiple places, including getting home at the end of the day or someplace you've driven forever, like your parents' house or your kid's house. You can get there on autopilot so that you don't even remember what was going on when you were there, because you were listening to the song on the radio or talking to your friend on your wireless Bluetooth, I'm hoping, right? That's how we create pathways. So I want to make creating new pathways even easier for you, so you're confident by the end of this time together that you can do it. Okay, so we're going to dive into the top three mistakes we make with habit change. The first is an all or nothing approach. And I have made all of these mistakes many times. So if you feel a little triggered as we talk about them, that's okay. We're creating awareness. And then once we're aware, we can shift, because knowledge is power. Okay. So triggering is actually good because it means you can change it. So when we think we have to do it right and we have to do it all, or it's just not worth it. Does that sound familiar? Like, what's the point? If I can't do it perfectly right and I can't do it every day and I can't do it consistently, what's the point? This is so common in our society and how we're raised as well. This is almost like a cultural mandate of like, if you're not doing it perfectly, then what's the point, right? This is a habit of thinking, and we tend to apply it automatically to most things. And I have a coaching mentor who says the way we do one thing is the way we do everything. So I want you to hold that in your brain somewhere in the back of your head and just notice that as you go through your day. How we do one thing is how we do everything. So a lot of us have a very perfectionistic, all or nothing, black or white approach to doing everything, including our habit changes, how we eat, how we work, how we relate to other people, how we either motivate or criticize ourselves, whether we deserve support of other people, including ourselves or not. This is a default setting in your brain. Okay. After we talk through these three mistakes, we're going to talk about how to shift them forever, so you never have to go back to them again. And you will slip back and forth as you're learning your new habit, because that's what we do. We walk the path back and forth a couple times before we decide to just go forward and make it our default. Okay. So all or nothing approach, very common mistake. And a lot of times we'll start taking action. It'll look like we're super motivated. And this is why the resolutions fail, because we've done it perfectly for 3 weeks. And then our friends invite us out to dinner and it's delicious. And we eat all the food and all the dessert. And then we spend the next like 3 days beating ourselves up and maybe kind of half following a plan. And then we're like, forget it. We're already off the plan. There's no point in going back on. What's the point? We're done. And then your resolution falls by the wayside. And your habit never gets changed because you've told yourself that it's not worth doing if you can't do it perfectly. Okay. All right. The second, number two, is focusing on changing our actions only. We all, you know, the beginning of the year or the beginning of the month, at the beginning of the week, we're like, yes, we're going to do this. And we want to jump into action. And we decide and we go for it. And we're motivated because we got energy and we can see that we're going to be successful. Right? Take credit for that. Celebrate that. That's awesome that you take action. Then what happens, right? Our brains freak out and it's new and it's awkward and it's uncomfortable. And it seemed like it was going to be really easy, but it's really not as easy to avoid the donut in the break room when you're tired and overworked and your boss just yelled at you. And then you're like, do I really want to do this? And your brain's like, danger, danger. This is awkward and uncomfortable. This must be dangerous. We better stop. Right? And then we talk ourselves out of restarting. I want to agree that planning our actions is important, but we want to fuel our actions. It's like filling up the gas tank in the car. If you're putting sand in there, yeah, I mean, it's good if you're at the beach, but it's not good to drive your car. You want to make sure you have the appropriate fuel backing up your actions. And we're going to talk about that in a minute too. Then the last mistake we all make is leading from fear or urgency. Think back to getting your arthritis first diagnosed. Most of us are freaked out when something bad or painful or new is happening, right? We feel like we need to change. We have to change all of it right now, or it's just going to get worse. And then we're going to curl up in a ball and die. Or be rejected and left by everyone. We're going to be left alone. Okay. Again, totally normal human brain function. When we think and express that we have to, or we need to, or we should do something or shouldn't do something, we're giving our power away. And that makes it much more likely that we're going to fail. Not when we fail, not if we fail, but when we fail. Not if we fail, but when we fail. I said that wrong. Because we always fail as we're doing new things. But the idea is to fail forward and not let that stop us in our tracks. But when we're leading and fueling with fear and urgency, I have to, I need to, I should, right? Should implies a judgment that we should do something or else. Okay. Then we're going to wander away at some point or give up or say, what's the point? Clearly we're unable and incapable of change, right? Trust me, same human brain you've got. What we don't realize is that how we're thinking, we have to change. We're subtly setting ourselves up for inner rebellion and self-sabotage. And y'all, I have done this so many times with my nutrition over the years that it's almost a joke now. I try to lose weight. I decide I'm going to lose a couple pounds or I want to get in better shape. And then I instantly find myself making cookies. You know how hard it is to make cookies and not sample them? Yeah, that's my silly brain doing its normal self-sabotage. And now when I catch myself even thinking like, well, I'm going to make some cookies and give them away or bring them to work, I notice that that is what's actually going on. Okay. So this happens, we notice this and we start off great and then we fade away or we wither out or something comes up that interrupts our exercise routine or our food change progress, like a delicious birthday cake celebration or dinner with friends or our kids got soccer starting or basketball and we just can't get in a routine, right? And then because we don't have a strong foundation underneath us, because we're leading from I have to or I need to or I should, just like that, our progress stops. All right, y'all, are you ready? This is the good stuff. We've all experienced one, more, all three of these mistakes, yeah? I know I have, like I said, repeatedly, because I got a real stubborn brain. It doesn't like to change. And this is how I got into learning how to create easier change that's fast and permanent, because I wanted the change for me. And then I started teaching it to my patients and then my clients. And now it's just, it's so awesome that I get to bring it to you. All right, I'm ready. You ready? Okay, I want everyone, we've been talking for like a half hour. I want everyone like either stand up or get up or just kind of wave your arms around, shake it out, shake it all off. Okay, we're just going to do a little dance break for a second. Yes, I am the crazy rheumatologist coach who's dancing in the middle of a webinar. That's me. Hi. Hi. I like dancing. It's fun. And I'm not nervous anymore, so I'm getting into it. Okay. All right. Next slide, please. Now you're going to learn how to get rid of those old stinky mistakes and shift tonight. The first shift, we want to go from all or nothing to a both and view of the world, which is an inclusive, abundant, sustaining perspective. Okay, this is important. You'll see it's a common theme across the three shifts we're going to make, but we want to be conscious and aware of this. And this is where the mindfulness and the awareness comes in. We want to shift from, I have to change my entire diet or it's not going to work, right? I've got to go keto. I've got to do paleo. I've got to try this new special diet. I've got to take out all gluten forever and ever, and I can never eat sugar again. And if I eat a banana, I'm going to beat myself up for 5 days, right? No, that doesn't work. We already know that, right? What's the point if I can't do blank perfectly? I'm drawing on my personal experience here and also my clients in the past. I failed today, therefore I'll never be able to change. These are all or nothing thoughts that kind of play on default, like on a reel, like the favorite song you have in your head, except it's not really helpful, that kind of song. We want to shift to a both and approach. I'm focusing on adding protein to my breakfast. So simple, so small. I'm going to take my vitamin with my coffee every morning because I already drink my coffee and now I'm going to take my vitamin. I'm going to walk in place for 2 minutes every day. Very, very different than I've got to change everything. I've got to go work out for an hour at a time, or what's the point if I don't do the water aerobics with all those awesome people that are just like moving and grooving for an hour and I'm 20 years younger and I can't do it. What's the point? To this is what I'm going to commit to and take action on no matter what. So the action step here with the both and shift is to establish a minimum baseline for any changes you're making and to take small steps. How we climb every mountain is one step at a time. The joke of how we eat an elephant, although I love elephants, so I've never eaten one, is one bite at a time. how we make any change is one small step at a time. So I want you to take that thing that you want to change and see if you can break it down into a smaller step and make it so simple that your confidence is 10 out of 10. Okay. So a minimum baseline is something that I use with my patients and my clients. And I actually just had a patient follow up today. And the last visit, she was saying, it's really hard to find time to exercise. I have small kids. I have a business, you know, I'm taking care of family and my arthritis flares up a lot. And I start an exercise program and then I fall off. And so last visit, we talked about the minimum baseline and she agreed to commit to, right? Commitment is when our actions and our behaviors are aligned, right? Our intent and our actions are aligned out of love and integrity for ourselves. And we're going to commit to it. It means we're going to show up and do it no matter what is going on. She could commit to 5 minutes of activity per day. And she said, yeah, oh, no problem. I can do that. Even if it's just like walking around while I'm waiting for my kids to get out of school, or I'm just going to walk up and down the stairs for 5 minutes. And so she came back today and I said, hey, by the way, how's that going? Were you able to do the 5 minutes like you thought? And she's like, actually, I was able to do 15 minutes every day since the last visit. And so we celebrated that because that's awesome. So the point of a minimum baseline is not to change all of your food. It's not to like overhaul everything at once, but it's to get your brain thinking differently about what one step can I take today to guarantee my success and my forward progress. This is also building a habit of trust with yourself, that you say you're going to do something and you do it. So you're in integrity and you're committed to it. And this in turn creates motivation. Okay. So every time we do a habit, we're changing our brain and we're changing our life and we're improving our health, right? Everybody here today is successful. I just want to offer that. You're here on this webinar. You decided, you saw it somewhere, you heard about it. You're like, I want to go and get something out of that. And you showed up for it. Or you're watching the replay. Kudos to you too. You are successful and you have to celebrate that because you want to grow and you're growing by just being here. And a lot of times we've created a habit of putting everyone else first and considering their needs and their health and their commitments first and putting all of ours last. This minimum baseline is designed to start shifting that and focusing on you and your needs and your health and creating a habit that's just who you are. I'm just a person who eats protein with every meal. I'm just a person who exercises for 5 minutes every day, whether it's stretching in my chair or in my bed before I get up. And we also want to talk a little bit about habit stacking. So take something that you're already doing and add this new minimum baseline to it. I get up in the morning and drink my coffee, and then I go for a 5 minute walk, or I walk in place for 5 minutes, right? I go into the bathroom 3 times a day. So while I'm in the bathroom, I'm going to sit down on the toilet and stand up 5 times. That's 5 squats right there. Or I eat lunch every day. So I'm going to add a vegetable to lunch every day. You get the point? We're doing really small, simple steps and stacking that on something you already do every day. And if your brain's offering you that you don't do the same things every day, that's not true. Just think about it for a little bit. Just let your mind wander and you'll come back to it. So an example of this for me is I brush my teeth regularly, right? Obviously. And then I wanted to start flossing because I'm really not good at flossing. So after I went to the dentist, I decided I'm going to floss every morning right after I brush my teeth. And I've done it now for 3 straight months. So I am just now a person who flosses in the morning. And this is how you shift from I've got to do it all at once, or there's no point. So that all or nothing, black or white thinking, to a minimum baseline to start building trust and knowing and being able to show up for yourself and keep your commitments. Okay. That's the first one, y'all. We got 2 more. All right. Next slide, please. All right. So instead of only focusing on changing your actions, you want to first pause for a second and focus on your mindset and what you're thinking about the change. And this has to do with our self-talk and our language, right? Talk is cheap. Actions are what create change. False. Actually, it comes from our thoughts and our energy, which are our feelings behind the change. And we're going to talk about this with the third step too. But if we're telling ourselves, I should eat this, or I need to do this, or I have to do this, then we're standing in our own way and we're creating a barrier there. And I want to tell you, this is not intentional. This is how most humans function at baseline. But when we're talking like this, we're expressing this either in words or in thoughts, we're out of our position of power. We're out of our authority and our agency. We've created a helpless situation where we're the victim and we have to do something or we need to do something. And man, that doctor's mean. They want me to quit smoking and change my eating and exercise. What the heck? Or I should do this. And that's where the judgment of ourselves comes up a lot, right? And it's very often that we find ourselves in this position and then we don't know how to get out of it. And I'm going to teach you how. And it's a very vulnerable place because it's also hard to admit that maybe you've put yourself in this position. And then we want to turn around and take blame for it instead of responsibility. And I've done a lot of this work personally in other areas of my life. And it took a long time for me to kind of release that shame of like, man, I was like being the victim there. And no wonder I couldn't change because I was blaming everyone else and myself. So what could I change, right? So when you're thinking in terms of I have to, I need to, I should, just notice and be aware that you're in the helpless observer or victim position. And it's a protective mechanism and a learned habit that you can shift, okay? And this won't be successful long-term because it's not loving. And we're going to talk more about what love's got to do with it in the next shift. I just want you to notice how you're phrasing your desire and your plan to change. What words and what language are you using? And what's the focus? How does it feel? Because when you feel pressured, when you feel like you have to get it done, you have to start now, that's not coming from a loving, compassionate, empowered place. So we're going to shift and start using, just notice when it comes up, just be like, oh, boop, we don't do that anymore. Boop, we're going to change the channel. Boop, that's not the song we're listening to anymore, right? I want to find foods that are at the intersection of healthy and nourishing and delicious for me and eat in that circle, right? What did I like doing and playing with when I was younger? Did I like dancing? Did I like going for a walk? Did I love being outside and just feeling the air on my face? I get to incorporate movement that feels good to me. Choosing a bedtime that works for you. I choose to do this instead of I have to do this. I should go to bed earlier, right? And then you're tossing and turning all night. I choose to go to bed here and I choose to get up here and I can choose to change my habit if it's not working for me. I want you to be empowered and be the owner and the authority of your health, both your mind and body health. So we just want to notice and redirect from that I have to, I need to, I should, to I get to, I choose to, I want to, before we start taking action, because otherwise we end up sabotaging ourselves. And I also want to offer, there's a lot of I can't language and I still use it all the time. And I've learned to replace I can't with I choose not to, because it just hits me differently. And it makes me kind of stop and be like, oh, yeah, totally. All right, so your action here is to observe your thoughts and your feelings first, and then with awareness, create your action plan steps from your own authority. Next slide, please. And I want to offer to you here and now that your thoughts and your feelings and your actions are what you have control over. Total power, total authority. You don't have control over other people. You don't have control over whether you have a diagnosis or not. You don't have control over anything that's going on outside you. But you always have control over your thoughts, your feelings, and your behaviors. And so that's why it's so important to start here, build that solid foundation, and then take inspired action from a caring, loving, motivated place, right? Your small steps add up. You want to start those tiny shifts until it's your default and then add another habit. And then you want to be able to do it every day. So it's just who you are. You're just that person that gets up and flosses after you brush, right? So some examples, if you couldn't think of something to break down that habit smaller, is to like eat one piece of fruit, walk maybe 1,000 steps, not the 10,000 your Fitbit and Garmin is telling you you have to, or drink 3 glasses of water a day, not 8, not 20, not 50, right? Start small. And I also want to encourage you to celebrate, because what we celebrate, we integrate. This creates faster change. It makes it more fun because we got to enjoy the journey or what's the point? And it creates that new neural pathway and solidifies it in your brain much, much faster because our brain likes to seek pleasure and escape pain and be efficient. That's its 3 main functions, right? It's avoiding danger, it's trying to keep you safe, and it's trying to be efficient. And celebrating helps that happen faster. Celebrating, playing, having a gratitude or appreciation habit, that all can be helpful for you. Okay, next slide, please. And I'm going to wipe my nose just for a second because it's itching. I'm still here with you. We are down to the third shift. We are on the home stretch, friends. You're doing great. Thanks for hanging with me. So the third shift is moving from fear or urgency into love. And listen, I'm not like a feeling person. I am a logical, rational, like ick feelings kind of person. So even talking about this at first, I was like, can I go for this on a webinar about arthritis? Yes, yes, I can. And as I've talked about it more, I've gotten more comfortable with it, but it's taken work for me to get here. So if you're like, ick, feelings, what the heck is she talking about? Just know I'm right there with you and I totally understand and it's totally okay. So just think about it and think how you might apply this in your situation for you. Remember, take what's good for you and leave the rest. You are the authority in your life. So when we're driving from fear or urgency, and that's what's fueling our habit change, fear is a signal that you're feeling unsafe or uncomfortable. And that creates urgency to try to move through faster to get to the other side to be comfortable again. And fear, unintentionally by default, drives most of our subconscious or unconscious thoughts, feelings, and actions, which are what hold us back from change and keep us stuck. This is why awareness and knowledge are so powerful, because if we're not aware of something, we can't change it, right? And our brains like to resist change. That's why we're talking about celebrating, making things fun. Hey, every day, if you're checking off your box of your minimum baseline, make it visual, make it something you can celebrate, because your brain likes positive reinforcement. When you're teaching a dog a new trick, you give him treats, right? Same thing with humans. If you're kicking the dog or hitting the dog or yelling at him because he's not getting the treat, that's not going to help. It's going to take longer. He's going to be like, hey, now I don't want to be around you. We do the same things to ourselves unintentionally. So think about celebrating as that positive reinforcement. I always tell people, get like a clear like glass or plastic and get rocks or marbles or something. And every day you're doing your habit, stick a marble in there and your brain goes, ooh, good. Or put a dollar in a jar, right? And then you get to a certain amount and then you buy a treat. Yeah, that works. I know it sounds silly and like hanky and like whatever, but it works. That's why we talk about it. Okay. This shifts us from fear to love. And as we're shifting from fear to love, it goes back to our self-talk. I have to, I need to, I should is fear-based thinking, because we think if we don't, then there's a consequence. My arthritis will get worse. No one will love me. I'll die, right? The worst case scenario. And we tend to talk and think more critically of ourselves than we do anyone else. We would never say most of the things that we mentally say to ourselves to anyone else, but especially not a small child. So another thing that's worked for me, and I heard this from another coach, is to get a picture of yourself as a child and put it somewhere, mirror in the bathroom, something else, and just look at it every day. And then consider how you're talking to yourself is how you're talking to that little kid. And if you want to change how that little kid grows up in the world, you can do that work now by shifting your self-talk to being more loving and more supportive and more caring and compassionate. And if from fear and like nastiness, right? How you talk to yourself right now is just not good at all. Going to love feels too far. Just seek neutral. Be like, yeah, it's okay. You're a human being on this planet. You're okay today. You don't have to be like, I love you in the mirror, all that stuff. You can just be like, yep, I did it today. I'm okay. And I had my own back. Something that feels not as extreme, not as all or nothing, right? A lot of us are in a place where we can give that positive self-talk, but some of us, it's harder to do that. We're just in such a dark place that it's like, I suck every day, right? What's the point? Why am I here, right? I also want to encourage you to talk to someone about that. Talk to your doctor, talk to a counselor, talk to a therapist. Get that out in the open, because if we hide it, it festers. If you bring it out, it'll dissolve faster, right? And you're already whole and worthy and lovable just as you are right now. I just want to throw that out there. But if you don't believe me, just believe it's possible that that's true. And then how would you treat yourself from there? How would you talk to the smaller version of yourself? Okay. We wouldn't kick a puppy. We'd give them treats to get them to change. This is kind of that same idea. I also want to say that you want to start where you are. a lot of us are like, well, I have to work out for like 3 months before I join the gym or else everyone's going to look at me and they're going to stare at me. Or I have to like eat all this food before I start my diet because I'm never going to be able to eat this food again. Right. And we have these plans of like, we have to get to a certain level before we can start. Not true. Start where you are right now, today, no matter how much pain or not you're having, no matter what you've done in the past, clean slate. Your past does not dictate your future unless you're bringing your fear of stuff in the past into the future with you. And that is something you do with your thoughts, your feelings, and your actions. So if you want something to change, we got to change here, and then we got to change our actions, and then we change those results and we create better health. So you always want to start where you are. You want to know where you are first, right? Awareness, knowledge, power. That's what meditation and mindfulness and all these practices are for, is to bring us back into ourselves, into our body, into our brain, and to slow us down. So self-criticism is a habit and it can be shifted with the three things we talked about today. You practice awareness and you notice what you're telling yourself. You notice what you're thinking about. You notice how you're feeling and you don't judge it or shame it or criticize it. You just witness it and you say, ow, that hurts. Why did I say that to myself? That's okay. We're going to stop saying that. I wouldn't say that to anyone else. And be okay with letting that part of you go. That critic served you up until now for a purpose, and you can let that go. And a lot of times you want to talk to a therapist or a coach or your doctor or someone else who's open to helping you and just kind of walk through that until you get comfortable with like, yeah, I'm going to support myself because I deserve to be supported. And I'm going to start with me, even if no one else in your life is on board. If your family's not on board with how you're eating, or they don't care if you exercise, even if you want them to kind of lose weight with you, because that's very common, it's okay to start with you because you don't know who you're inspiring. Because a lot of times people are having the same thoughts and feelings. And when you start and you make progress and you're able to show up for yourself and create a minimum baseline, and enjoy your habits and celebrate yourself and shift that self-talk and say, I get to, and be empowered, you're going to inspire so many people because other people are always watching and you don't even have to say anything. You don't have to try to get them to do it with you. You don't have to nag them about anything. You just do it. And you're like, yeah, this is just who I am now. This is who I'm becoming. And you can come or you can stay. That's fine. Right. And then accepting yourself where you are. Allowing yourself to be who you are, be in your body, feel what you feel, and feel safe. That is what love is. So we want to shift from that fear and that urgency. And what that looks like is, I can do this today. And maybe you're hurting today and you decide, I choose not to do my minimum baseline today, right? Not, I can't. I choose not to because. And just write it down and make yourself a note and then reevaluate that at the end of the day and be like, yeah, that was a loving decision. But then the next day, maybe it's a loving decision to get right back on that horse and keep taking small steps forward. Okay. Love is setting boundaries with yourself and with other people. Love is honesty with yourself and with other people. Love is kindness and compassion. It's addressing hurtful comments that we make to ourselves and maybe other people make to us, and setting a boundary, being like, hey, if you talk to me like that, I'm going to walk away. And that's okay. We're getting above the scope of the practice, but also encouraging yourself and celebrating. All right, next slide, please. Okay, so we're going to check in right now. We are on the home stretch. We are done with the meat and the content, and we're going to get to questions in a minute. So I just want you to check in with your minimum baseline. What's that one small step that you can do every day from a 9 or a 10 out of 10 confidence that will take you closer to the habit that you want? I want you, and you can do this after we're done or while we're doing questions, just outline a tiny step and when you're going to do it. I want you to stack it with something you already do. So basically you're going to do the thing you normally do, and then you're going to do the habit right after, and you're going to kind of buddy them together. So you're going to buddy up your habits, a habit you already have and a habit that you want to create. And then I want you to create support with 3 or 4 thoughts that you can kind of use to be your own cheerleader. What can you do to support your new habit and solidify it? Okay. And I have some ideas for this. So if you want to steal mine, that's fine. I like that I get to do this differently and I get to have fun doing it. That always motivates me because I like having fun. I choose to or get to create more fun in my life by doing this habit. I choose to love myself no matter what. I choose to have my own back and build the habit of having my own back no matter what happens, no matter whether I do my minimum baseline, no matter whether someone's making fun of me for it, no matter whether they're like, oh, now you're all woo-woo, you know, with your mindset work. Yes, yes, because come to the dark side. It's awesome here. We have fun and cookies. Just kidding. There's no cookies. I haven't found them yet unless I bake them. Anyway, or I choose to support myself through this change, even when it feels challenging. And those two words are really powerful. You can use any supportive statements and say, even when I'm tired, even when I'm hurting, even when I'm going to show up for myself out of love and compassion and trust and knowing and believing that I can change this habit. Okay. I want you to create a list of celebrations that you can do for your daily wins. So make a list of 5 to 10 things that you really enjoy doing and decide, like, when I get to like 5 days of my new habit or 20 days of my new habit or 30 days of my new habit, or, you know, I've accomplished, like, I've lost 5 pounds or I've been to the gym 10 times and I got my little, you know, check marks and my gold stars on my calendar, or like my little rocks in a glass. I am going to celebrate by doing this. I'm going to take myself to the movies. I'm going to go buy this cute purse. I'm going to go with my kids and go to an amusement park, whatever. Just make a list of 5 to 10 things, some small, some big, and then just pick off your celebration list. And don't withhold them from yourself. Celebrate every day in small ways. So I like to have a little dance party. I had like 3 dance parties today with patients and staff. It's just fun and it helps to solidify new changes. And then how will you approach your self-talk on those days where you're tired, where you're hurting, where you're just over it, right? You're just stressed out, you're overwhelmed. What are you going to do to be graceful, and how will you honor yourself on those days? I want you to make just a quick list of that. And then you can put this up somewhere, either in your bathroom, your kitchen, on the fridge, take it with you to work, get a copy at work, copy at home, copy in the car, just to remind your brain of what you learned here tonight. And what you're committing to with your minimum baseline and how you're going to support yourself through those changes. Okay, next slide. Yay, you did it. I'm so excited for you. I'm so excited for us. We made it. We're going to pause here for a second. I want to celebrate you. You just created a change in your habits. You are thinking and feeling differently already about your health and about your habits, even if your brain's like, nuh-uh, no, I'm not, no way, right? You already sat and listened, so it will be creating a change, even though you don't notice it right away. You understand better why forcing yourself to change does not work. And you now know how to create permanent changes that last and feel much simpler than an all or nothing approach. And you know why that doesn't work. You've created your success plan, either mentally or by writing it down on the worksheet or a piece of paper, and you have all the supportive mindset tools that you need to feel confident, even when you're changing and it feels challenging or awkward or uncomfortable. Your ability to change and get yourself through and take that step is always one thought away. And I love the thought of, I can do this. This is possible for me. Okay. You also have gotten your power back. You get to create healthy habits to support your thriving life with arthritis. You are not your diagnosis, right? You're not your RA. You're not your spondyloarthritis. You're not your osteoarthritis. You are a human who just happens to have arthritis, and you get to choose what you do to support yourself and to feel better in conjunction with your team and your support and everyone around you, but you are the authority on your life and your body. The more you celebrate, the faster you create new ways of being both in your brain and in your life around you. The changes you make will solidify faster, and they'll be easier and more fun for you to sustain and maintain, and this will create more motivation for you. We often mistakenly think that motivation comes before we start taking action. Motivation comes as we're taking action. It helps build momentum, right? So habit change kind of looks like this as it goes up on the graph. If you've ever seen one of those graphs, we think change is linear like this. Change is actually up, down, up, down, up, down, but in an upward direction. So I just want you to keep that in mind. And you've got your plans and your tools, and you get to decide right now and commit that you are the person who is healthier for being here and has a new habit to look forward to. Thank you guys so much. I'm going to have you get up, do another happy dance. We're going to celebrate that we finished, right? And then we're going to summarize. So you guys continue to do your happy dance while we're summarizing. Next slide, please. We already kind of summarized, but we talked about creating awareness to create change. You want to shift your mind first. You want to start small, smaller than you think you need to. And your brain is going to tell you it's not enough. Ignore it. It's wrong. It's a thought error. Okay. Start small. What do you have to lose? You build a new habit and you grow trust in yourself while you do it. And then you can make the habit bigger, right? You can always go bigger. You learned how to establish a minimum baseline and why that's important. You learn to take action from love, notice fear or urgency, and then refocus it to be productive. What you focus on expands. If you're focusing on your pain, if you're focusing on your problem, if you're focusing on what's not working, you're staying in that victim mentality. When you're focusing on the solutions of how you can change, of how you can move forward, you're acting from love, which creates more love, which creates more health, which creates more safety, and allows your brain to shift faster. Celebrate every small win along your journey to solidify your change, make it more fun, and help it happen faster. And then I want you to play. Make it a fun game. Just ask your brain, like, how can I do this even better? What would be more fun for me? And just go from there. Take what works for you, leave the rest. I promise it will work for you. Next slide. Thank you guys so, so much for coming tonight. And thank you for being here for you and investing this time and energy into learning a new way to create new habits. I have more resources available on my website, thrivearena.com. You scroll down a little bit. It says /my stress. You click on that. You put your name and your email in. You get a free stress reduction download that helps you slow down enough to reduce your stress in the moment. It takes less than 5 minutes. It's a three-step process. It works super quick and it will build on what we talked about today. So if overwhelm and stress is a big thing for you, I highly recommend that. I have my podcast at Reclaim Your Brain, which is on Spotify. It's on Google. It's on Apple. You can find it off my website as well. And then SherelleMoreTucker.com has a ton of resources and she's got cool stuff there. She's got clothes, she's got candles, she's got classes and a ton of free resources on yoga, on mindfulness, on meditation. Okay. So I want you guys to check out these awesome free resources. And I want to thank you so, so much. It has been a pleasure hosting this session for you tonight. And honestly, so much fun. Thank you for coming. Thank you for spending the time with us. To continue this work, you have your resources. Sherelle has great resources. And then I'm going to ask Sherelle now to come back on so we can do our Q&A and then we will break.
Wow.
Hi, Sherelle.
Hi, that was absolutely amazing. So many nuggets. I have some great notes here. I really appreciate your three method approach. And so we're going to go now into our Q&A session, and we have our first question. And this question says, the disability and isolation from arthritis has led me into a pattern of emotional eating. What do you recommend for me to break that habit? So this is about emotional eating due to the isolation.
Yeah. And the first step, like we talked about, is always awareness. So the fact that you're aware of the emotional eating is fantastic. So if you haven't celebrated yourself that you're aware of that, whoop, whoop, props to you, because that's a hard thing and it's a common thing. So even though you feel isolated, I want you to know you are not alone by far. I am an emotional eater by background. I know a lot of people do it. It's very common. The first step is awareness. The second step is deciding that you want to change, right? And you can apply what we talked about tonight is to set a minimum baseline for yourself. How do you want to treat yourself when you're feeling sad, when you're feeling alone, when you're feeling isolated, and it has you going to the pantry or reaching for the food? What do you want to do instead? And what are you really hungry for? Are you hungry for connection? Are you hungry for soothing? Are you hungry for love? Are you hungry for just support? And how else can you get that other than the food? And this is something I do every day. I get tired midday. especially at work. And I find myself, I get snacky, my face wants to eat, right? Yeah. And it's real. The struggle is real because I'm like, oh, I could just eat some nuts. They're in my desk. And then I'm a lot of times just slowing down enough to acknowledge, yes, I want something emotionally, but I'm not physically hungry. So yes, this is an emotional eating scenario. And then what is it that I want? And just sitting with yourself and breathing with yourself and being like, it's okay that I want to go eat and I'm not going to, but I'm going to do this instead. I'm either going to sit quietly. I'm going to call a friend or family member. And maybe you tell them ahead of time, like, hey, I'm breaking this habit and I'm creating this change and I would love your support. And if you don't have someone for support, create something. Facebook. I mean, the online communities are huge mm-hmm. and there's always someone out there who's going through the same thing. And it's very common for our brains to tell us we're alone and we're the only ones and we're the special snowflake. It's literally not true. And I'm sorry that you're feeling isolated. And trust me, I feel that so deeply because I know the pain of turning to food because you feel like you don't have any other options. And it's just such a deeply ingrained habit, but be willing to be uncomfortable and decide how you want to move forward and then commit to making that change and just being loving and compassionate with yourself, whether you choose to eat at that point or not. I mean, that's the biggest thing is the more we can show ourselves love and compassion, the habit sometimes will just shift on its own.
Mm. That is, I love that. And I so appreciate whoever asked this question. I hope you feel supported in that. I think there's some amazing self-awareness that's already there because the person said they realize they have an eating pattern. So evidently you've kind of you have some self-awareness that it's a pattern. So hopefully that was helpful to that person that posed the question. For our second question we have, how do you find the motivation to exercise when you're fighting constant pain, fatigue, and fear or flaring? This is a big one. You know, people want to know, you know, how do you find the motivation when you're in pain and it's staring you in the face?
Yeah. Sherelle, do you want to tackle that one first and then I'll comment in?
Sure.
I have a feeling you kind of maybe know about this one.
I do. And it, you know, I took some notes and I know this one very well because I was sharing with on a Connect group that, you know, when you have those days when you feel invincible and you're out and you're doing your 3, 5, 10,000 steps, it feels like, oh, I'm on the mend, like I can really beat this thing. And then a day or two or a week or two, you have a flare up and I'll just speak for myself. I feel so down, like, oh, I thought I was, you know, on an uphill journey to, you know, a recovery. And then those setbacks can really stifle your motivation. And I think one of the things that you mentioned were small, simple steps. When I lack the motivation or I can't find the motivation, I refocus on the small steps and not so much on what I deem as a failure or, you know, I didn't do something perfectly. I focus on other things, other habits that I have as part of my life. One of the habits that I've been implementing is drinking more water. It's something that we all do, but we can do a better job of. So I actually got a water bottle that has time on it because I have a connection to time. It actually has 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock. I noticed that when I had water bottles that just had the number of ounces, it didn't really resonate. And this kind of keeps me on track with, oh, I did all of my water today. I'm connected to the time. And so I focus on celebrating the small steps that I've made. And that gives me the motivation to try the next day to implement those things that maybe were very hard during those days when I was flaring.
I think that, yeah, that's all excellent. And I think you touched on something very important is that our best looks different every day.
Every day.
And that's why, again, with the minimum baseline, a lot of times I recommend like way less than you think you should be doing or what, you know, your brain is like, well, I should be out there doing this and I should be out there every day. And also giving yourself that grace when you're in pain already. And I understand you're having pain. You're afraid that you're going to have more pain if you do more activity, right? And then a lot of us will have a good day and we do more and then we feel more pain the next day. And we're like, yes. See what happened. And again, that's kind of that all or nothing. And it's finding what you can do. and doing it and then reinforcing from there and kind of, like you said, building on the habit. And that's why I was saying, like, the graph of like improvement we think goes like this. So it's actually like you're good one day, you're bad the next day, you're good one day, you're bad the next day. But over time, those results do compound. And that's part of that rebuilding that trust with yourself mm-hmm. and really acting out of love and compassion versus fear. And I want to speak to that fear and the fatigue with exercise, especially because it's so common with arthritis. We're afraid that if we do any activity, we're going to be more tired. We're going to be in more pain. We're not going to be able to move. So it is important to talk with your doctor and make sure it's okay for you to be exercising, because I have had patients that just push through. And when they're already flaring and inflamed, it does make it worse. Mm-hmm. So we have to talk about, like, maybe some days you can walk. Maybe some days all you can do is sit in your chair and stretch. Right. Yes. Like with the pandemic, I was all about YMCA with my patients on telemedicine just to give you range of motion, but it also makes it fun. So it's also the self-talk of like, I have to do this 30-minute chair yoga, right? Versus right. I can do 2 minutes of stretching today and I'm going to let that be okay and love myself through it and then reevaluate. Could I do another 2 minutes later? Maybe, maybe not. But starting much, much smaller. I have recommended 1 minute of exercise to people before. Mm-hmm. And people are like, well, yeah, that's not enough. Right. And I'm like, it is. It really is, because it also gets you in a different mindset right. of being able to do something, show up for yourself and do it repeatedly, right? Because you're building two skills at once. And so I hope that's helpful for the person yeah. who asked the question. Thank you. That's such an important question. And definitely partnering with your healthcare specialist to be like, is it okay? And is this type of activity okay? And that's why I recommend pool exercise a lot, because it takes the weight off the joints. Mm-hmm. It makes it a lot easier to even just walk in the pool, or even if you just have a hot tub, you stretch, even the bathtub or the shower, you get in there, you know, make sure you're not on a slippery surface, but just moving a little bit, it reconnects the body and the brain. It also gives you that kind of endorphin and that optimism that, yes, I can move in certain ways, maybe not the way I want to yet, but I can move.
Awesome. Thank you, Dr. Rook. We have two more questions. The next question is, the person asks, what are some tips for combating PTSD that has made arthritis and pain worse? Can you share any tips as it relates to this question?
Yeah, and PTSD is a common, especially for our military population. PTSD has with it a host of issues that relate to pain as well. And chronic pain syndromes are very common with PTSD, which a lot of people I don't think are aware of, that chronic pain kind of goes along with it. It's not just one diagnosis, because the brain and the body are connected. And with PTSD, and I'm not an expert on PTSD by any means, but my understanding is the brain kind of just shuts down because it was something that was so overwhelming, it couldn't be processed. And when something's pushed down or pushed away, similar to stress, but not as extreme, the body eventually absorbs that stress and it comes out in other ways. And very commonly, it comes out as a pain syndrome or a pain sensitization. And so definitely seeking treatment and getting treatment for the PTSD is just as important as addressing the pain. Awesome. And so, yeah, the mental mindset, emotional health aspect of addressing the PTSD is important. And it's something that I talk with all of my patients with, especially if they have that trauma history.
Okay, that's great. I hope that was edifying for the person that asked that question. The next question that we have says, why do we flare? What are we doing wrong to cause flares and habits to prevent them? So this question is specifically, you know, why do we flare and what are we doing wrong to cause the flare?
We have another 3 hours. Yeah. No, I'm just kidding. It's kind of an in-depth question.
Yeah.
Let me see. Simple answer. Why we flare is multifactorial. Different types of arthritis can flare for different reasons, but certainly lifestyle habits, including, you know, stress, nutrition, movement, hydration can all contribute to flare symptoms. Overworking, overdoing it can flare. If your disease process is not well controlled and you're kind of fluctuating, a lot of times people will flare. If it's undertreated and you have kind of smoldering disease, especially I'm more speaking towards inflammatory types of arthritis, it feels controlled and maybe you have a higher pain threshold. So you just kind of say, yeah, I'm okay. But you're really not, because you have a little bit of smoldering disease. And I'm just pointing to the fingers because that's pretty common. That can kind of tip off a flare more commonly, or if you overdo it. And like I said, if you're feeling really good and you're like mentally, like, I'm going for it, I'm going to run the 5 miles. And the next day you're like, oh, maybe not the best idea.
That's that me, unfortunately. Yeah.
That can commonly cause flares. And it's a little bit of trial and error. And like that fear comes in, right? We overdo it and then we're afraid to go for it again. But it's also dialing it back. And like our ego gets involved at that point. We're like, but I was an athlete and I should be able to do this. And that shoulding comes in, right? That judgment, that self-criticism, and being able to kind of notice that and kind of step back and be like, yeah, old me should have been able, could have done that. Should have been able to, dialing it back and then finding that balance of new normal of what's okay to do and is not going to cause a flare versus like what's not okay, what's overworking, overexerting. So that was kind of the simple answer to that, but that's a really detailed question. So I hope that was helpful.
Yeah,
I definitely something to talk with your provider about.
I think that was very helpful. So we have another question. And I think this question, it reads, when focusing on weight loss as a goal, what's most important, cutting carbs, calories, or exercise? So I just want to speak to this briefly because this webinar is mainly focused on, you know, resolutions and how to make habit changes. And I would just recommend that the person that asked this question definitely check out the Arthritis website, which has a lot of great information on diet and exercise and what are some good options for that. So thank you for the question. And let's see if we have anything else. Oh, we have one more. And this person says, I have RA because I, quote, look okay, people think I am okay. Still trying different meds without complaining to others. What can I do to cope? People don't understand the daily pain that I have. Yeah, okay. I think this is really common. I feel this way too, especially I'm 47, but I know that some people think I'm younger. So when you try to describe the pain and how it's chronic, a lot of people don't understand chronic pain because you look fine according to what they see in front of you.
Yeah. And I think that's an important thing. And I actually had this conversation with a patient this week about the silent diseases that we treat, because a lot of people, you know, we all judge, you know, kind of on default. It's how our brain kind of scans and that person looks okay. That person looks okay. Well, that person's in a wheelchair. They must be hurting. Right. And it's a cultural thing as well. I think one of the things that you can do to cope is just let go of what anyone else thinks. Obviously easier said than done, right? Yeah. But at the same time, if you are hurting, it's okay to express that and say, you know, I have an inflammatory condition where my body's attacking my joints and it's not well controlled right now. And I'm tired and I'm hurting. So please excuse me if I don't participate as well today, or I'm not as focused. And if you don't want to share what your disease or your diagnosis is, you can just kind of make a general statement and say, you know, I have a diagnosis that I don't care to share, but I do have pain and I do have other issues associated with it. So I would appreciate your compassion. And then people can decide. And some of it is setting boundaries more than coping, because like I said, we don't have control over anyone else, but we have control over what we think, how we feel, what we do, and how we want to approach it. So I would put the question kind of back on the person who asked it and say, what do you want to do? How do you want to cope with it? Do you want to just be like, shh, and walk away? Do you want to engage them in conversation and attempt to educate them? Because a lot of times when we're tired and hurting, we don't want to be that person to educate. We just want to be like, you suck. I don't want to be around you, and walk away. And that's okay too. I wouldn't necessarily tell them they suck, but you could express it in a diplomatic way. If you were so inclined, just say, you know, I have something going on and I don't feel safe sharing that with you, but just know that if I would, if I could, but I can't, so I'm not going to right now.
I think that's great. I think that being able to not put pressure on yourself to explain to the person if you are in pain, is great, because sometimes we feel obligated to try to get someone to understand our pain. And I love the fact that you said, you know, you're not there to educate if you don't feel like it. And so thank you. Thank you so much for that. Let's see, do we have any more questions? So one thing that I did want to share is as it relates to getting started with a mindfulness practice, Dr. Rook, she mentioned a couple of things that I want to encourage those that may be interested in meditation and yoga. Of course, based on what your doctor recommends, but yoga has a very great entry point. You don't have to get on the mat or get on the floor to practice yoga. I do a lot of chair yoga, YMCA, just like Dr. Rook mentioned. And I think it's a great way to move your body. And meditation is a great way to, if you're having a flare, and I do this as well, if I'm having a flare and movement is just not an option for that day, I find deep, deep comfort in being able to focus just on my breathing and doing breathing exercises or listening to a guided meditation. Those are part of my small steps that build the house for lifestyle changes. So I just wanted to mention that. And I also want to thank Dr. Rook for lending her expertise tonight. I hope that you all got something out of creating your own action plan and using the 3-step method that she mentioned. There are lots of resources that she provided. Definitely check out her podcast. And with that, thank you so much for lending your time and your expertise to us tonight.
Thank you, Sherelle. And thank you to the Arthritis Foundation. And thank you to everyone who came tonight. I love you all. And hopefully we can do this again sometime soon. Y'all take care and have a good night.
Awesome. Awesome. Thank you so much. And we know that we're running a little bit behind time, but we want to bring your attention to our last slide before we log off for the night. Just as some reminders, we have some great connect groups. I'm actually a part of one of the groups, and I would highly recommend that you check it out. Connectgroups.arthritis.org. We also have webinars for those. I think I saw in the question and the Q&A session that some people said that they logged on late. However, this webinar will be available on our website, arthritis.org/webinars. So you can look for that probably in the next couple of days or weeks or so. And I'm very excited about our next webinar. This webinar is scheduled for February 23rd. It is Taming Inflammation with Culinary Medicine. Mark your calendars, everyone, for February 23rd. This is going to be a great one, and you don't want to miss it. We're going to have 2 renowned experts in holistic nutrition who will discuss how to blend the art of cooking and nutrition to help tame arthritis inflammation. And even in March. So you got 2 great webinars coming up. Sleep Solutions. Sleep Solutions for Pain, March 22nd. We will be focusing on a panel of experts who will share tips and pain management strategies to help dial down pain for a better night's rest. We also have our podcast, arthritis.org/podcast, where you can get more information, more resources, and everyday people talking about how they're living with arthritis. It is a great support system, and I definitely recommend that you tune in. We also have our helpline, our 1-800 number. You can also reach our helpline through arthritis.org/helpline. And we also have some insights available. Within maybe a few days or so after this, you're going to receive a survey. I know that you all are busy, busy people, but we highly, highly encourage you to complete our survey, where we're going to be asking about your experience with tonight's webinar. So we ask that you please take some time to fill out the survey, honestly, so that the foundation can do its best to serve you in the future. That completes our webinar tonight with our upcoming events and resources. Make sure you bookmark those things that you find on the website and mark your calendars for these two webinars that are coming up in February and March. It has been my pleasure to serve as your moderator tonight. I hope that you have been encouraged. I hope that you share this webinar with others that are living with arthritis. And I hope, most importantly, that you will take action with those action plans that you implemented today. And so with that, I'll close with just an affirmation for us all to live well, to be well, and to rest easy. Good night, everyone.